Okay, so I've been asked to introduce Christophe, and it is my great pleasure to do so. So for those of you who don't know him, Christophe works at the Département de Physique Nucléaire of IRFU, where he is currently the deputy director. His field of expertise is the topic of this conference, so synthesis and properties of superheavy nuclei. But before he became involved in superheavy element research, Christophe was a high spinner like me and like some of us in the audience. And he did his PhD in Strasbourg on superdeformation in rare earth nuclei with Eurogam. So after his PhD, he got hired at Saclay, where he developed in collaboration with Bordeaux, the Saclay Aquitaine photovoltaic cells for isomer research, SAFIR in short, that was successfully used at Eurobo, and many publications came out of the use of that, in particular for identification of isomeric states in fission fragments, for example. Then about the turn of last century, probably motivated by the discovery of the rotational band in Nobelium-254 at Jyväskylä and at the same time at Argonne, he became interested in superheavy nuclei and started a very fruitful collaboration, which is still ongoing, with Jyväskylä to perform prompt and decay spectroscopy of, in particular, odd-Z, Lawrencium, Mendelevium, and Einsteinium isotopes. He also developed the box for electron spectroscopy after tagging, the BEST array, that was used at the focal plane of the Lee spectrometer in Ganil to study the fine structure alpha decay of Lawrencium-255. And he continued in that on that route and developed another device. He was the successful laureate of an ANR, and he developed the device called MUSET for recoil decay tagging, this time at VAMOS at Ganil, which was commissioned now, I think, nearly 10 years ago. Of course, Christophe has also been heavily involved in the VAMOS gas field project, which still awaits commissioning, and of course, the S-Cube project. Finally, I must not forget to mention Christophe's implication in the AGATA project, which he has contributed to since the very beginning. He was the team leader of the ancillary detector and electronics team, and then he became the head of the DAC working group for many years, and he is currently the member of the AGATA steering committee. And so now I hand over the microphone to Christophe, and he will tell us all about superheavy nuclei.
Okay, so thank you very much for this introduction and also for the opportunity to give this seminar on superheavy nuclei. Okay, so the study of superheavy is often illustrated with a map with a somewhat enigmatic island of stability that the physicists are trying to reach. And this map actually was revisited by Zoé Favier, one of our PhD student. So it is for sure a region full of unknown. We can try to explore the Terra Incognita, which is actually a sea in this picture, and in particular the heaviest nuclei at the very top of the nuclear chart. And however, this is an option followed by very few labs only because of the very small cross section and the enormous time spent for to obtain few events only. Also, it is not necessarily easier. We can study lighter nuclei in detail. For instance, here some deformed nuclei. And in this presentation, I will try to address both aspects. The exploration of the extremes with the discovery of the first transuranium nuclei, and on the other hand, the detailed study in the form of nuclei, in the region of lighter nuclei. Since this region is very rich, I cannot give a full overview of superheavy nuclei. Actually, some aspects were already covered by Wally in a ResNet seminar last year, last November, I think. And as a continuation of this seminar, I have chosen to talk first about the discovery of transuranium nuclei using neutrons, neutron captures. On the same topics of neutron capture, I will discuss the air process nucleosynthesis. We will see whether or not nucleosynthesis is able to produce super heavy nuclei. We will see also that the theory is mandatory to perform the nucleosynthesis calculation. Therefore, I will talk a bit about the theory from the first calculation made in the 16 to the current hot issues, especially in deformed nuclei. And then I will show a few experimental results, studies in deformed nuclei, some results and technique. And if I have time, I will finish with some trends for the future. So let's start with the first studies of neutron capture performed by Fermi and his group in 1933-34, just after the discovery of the neutrons of the neutron by Chadwick. And the idea of Fermi was to send neutrons on a sample, then to capture this neutron, and after beta decay, it produced a new isotope with the same number of nucleons, but with a proton change, no, the opposite, sorry, a neutron change into a proton. So after that, they did, in some cases, a chemical separation, and they detected the beta minus radioactivity using a Geiger-Müller counter shown here, very small detector. And they were able to measure the lifetime and eventually the beta minus energy absorber. To produce the neutrons, they use the reaction alpha and beryllium using a radon alpha source. And they did some systematic investigation in Roma of this neutron and neutron reaction along the periodic table from hydrogen to uranium. Maybe not in that order, but for sure, they arrive to uranium. Okay, and with this technique, they discovered about 30 new isotopes. Okay, so they have uranium, and they found strong evidences for the production of element 93 and 94. So the Fermi group was very confident that they discovered this element. All through in the Nature paper, they are... it's not that clear, there are little dots, let's say. Unfortunately, this work could not continue for a long time because the Roma group dispersed from 1935. Razzetti, he left in 35 to the US and then to Canada. Pontecorvo, who took this picture, he left in 36 for France, then Canada, then UK, and then he disappeared and reappeared in the Dubna a few years after. Segre, here, he left to the US in 38, and Fermi, famous Fermi, he left in the US after his Nobel conference, where he talked about many other subjects about neutron irradiation. And Amaldi, in the middle, he left... for the US in 39. Okay, so this group was quite confident they discovered osmium and hesperium. And not so many, well, the experiments were also repeated in Berlin, starting from 35, by some chemists, Anne Meitner and Strassmann, who were already very reputed radiochemists. And actually, they could confirm the work of Fermi and collaborator, and even more, they published this paper where they claimed that element up to 97 was produced. And again, the Fermi results were not questioned because of his huge prestige. And also, again, these chemists were well known. So the experiment was repeated also in a different, using a different method in Berkeley, using a cyclotron as a neutron source, but no conclusive results were found. Okay. So, as you know, this interpretation turned out to be wrong, because the activities were due, in fact, to barium, to some barium isotopes, as proven by Hahn and Strassmann, using a very sophisticated radiochemist experiment. And this was, as you know, quickly interpreted correctly by Lise Meitner and his nephew Otto Frisch. Lise Meitner has to leave Germany for Denmark at the period. But this is another story. This was the story of the discovery fission. So obviously this cartoon is a bit strange because it's not Lise Meitner who visited Niels Bohr, but Otto Frisch. We discussed with him this fantastic discovery, and you know the story of Bohr telling, "Oh, what idiots we are! We all have been. This is just as is, at least must be." So finally, there were some attempts in Berkeley to discover element 93 by Segre and Macmillan. The first experiment was not positive, but the proof came in 1940 by Macmillan and Albertson. Macmillan is here, I think, near the Berkeley 16-inch cyclotron. They produce the neutron using the deuteron and beryllium reaction, and they measure a new activity, 2.3 days, and they were able to prove that it was due to element 93. And the key of this experiment was the correct detection of a beta minus particle with quite low energy. And the name Neptunium was given by Macmillan, I think. Then the year after, element 94 was detected by Seaborg and his team. Not using neutron, but directly reaction deuteron and uranium. And they gave the name plutonium, which was a serif planet, but it seems that at the beginning they hesitated and wanted to give the name extremium and ultimium, since they thought they had reached the limit of the periodic table. So the paper were published only in 1946, because at that time there were first voluntary restriction to publish, and later all this work were classified. Okay, so there were several, as I said before, there were several attempts to identify Neptunium using chemistry. And the method was the basic idea is that element 93, as shown in this periodic table, in the same colloid as the triad rhenium, the not yet discovered technetium and manganese. But actually, this was a mistake, let's say, because it was realized and suggested by Glenn Seaborg that actually Neptunium is not in the same column, but in the actinide series, which is similar to the lanthanide series. It's not in the same column, but it's I would say an extension of the periodic table. So the actinide concept was then discovered by Glenn Seaborg, which got the Nobel Prize for the discovery of some actinide. Okay, so a bit later, the other element from 95 to 98 were discovered by Seaborg and Thomson and collaborators, still using the Berkeley 16-inch cyclotron, and identified using either alpha decay, beta minus, or electron capture. Okay, the discovery of element 99 and 100 is a bit different. They were discovered using the thermonuclear explosion, the first thermonuclear explosion actually of the EV Mike bomb, which was a 10 megaton bomb, something like 1,000 more than the uranium bomb. This was a what they did actually, some plane collected some debris in the cloud, and they were sent to Los Alamos. But at the same time, Guerzo he heard about this the discovery of new alpha line, and he managed to obtain some sample. And after a careful analysis, he could identify Einsteinium 253 and Fermium 255. And in total, something like 15 new isotopes were discovered in this event. And there was actually a long program to discover new super heavy elements using thermonuclear explosion. About 30 explosions were made until 1958. However, the heaviest element found was fermium 257 only. In this EVMIC event, some neutrons were captured from uranium 235. So uranium 235, it present its surroundings, the bomb itself, because it's used as an X-ray mirror, let's say. And so the uranium capture something like 17 neutrons, and then after beta decay, they reach Einsteinium and fermium region. And the question maybe is how far can we go in capturing neutrons, and can nature do better in the universe with a nucleosynthesis? So as you may know, in the universe, the method to produce heavy elements is the air process. So this is a capture of neutron, starting from iron, followed by beta minus decays. So in a star, it's not possible to produce, in a normal star, let's say, produce element heavier than iron, because you cannot make fusion above iron, because you need to provide extra energy. This is because the maximum of binding energy is around iron in the Aston curve. Okay, so the only possibility is to capture neutrons, and this was understood in particular in this famous B2FH paper in 1957. And they understood that to perform this kind of reaction, you need a huge neutron flux and an explosive process. So huge neutron flux to produce this series of capture and beta minus decay, and explosive to disperse the elements. And the first site considered for air process, one of the first sites, was a core collapse supernova. A core collapse supernova is the end of life of the massive star, at least 10, 12 solar masses, which collapses because the combustion is no more possible. So the core collapses and then explodes. And during the collapse phase, the conditions are met for the air process with this huge neutron flux. And after the dispersion, the elements are dispersed with the explosion. So this core collapse phase is quite short. It's about 1 second, but actually much longer than a thermonuclear explosion, which is only something like 1 microsecond. So first core collapse supernova, and then in the 2017, Latimer and Schramm suggested the possibility to have air processes in black hole neutron star collision. So surprisingly, the collision of a neutron star with a black hole was considered before the collision of two neutron stars, which was actually a few years later. So at that time, I think almost nobody believed in the neutron star black hole scenario, but it became popular only 20 years ago, about 20 years ago, when several predictions were made. In particular, you can find a nice summary in this paper by Stefan Gurrielli. And a lot of papers have been published on the air process in a neutron star merger, neutron star black hole merger. The proof that it was not not just a concept was found was observed in 1997 with the detection of the neutron star major GW 1708-17. So actually, this was not the first observation of a gravitation whale, but the first evidence for a two neutron star merger. So this detection was a huge success because they could detect the electromagnetic counterpart, which is also known as a multi-messenger observation. And here are examples of infrared spectra measured with a telescope, the Grand telescope based on Earth, where they see the light emitted after the collision. So what is the process? So after the collision, just after the collision, the air process nuclear synthesized in an accretion disk ejected after the merger, and this phase is very fast, something like 1 or 2 seconds, a few seconds, let's say 1 second or a few seconds. And what they did, and after this phase, there is an intense light emitted, which is called a kilonova. And this light is due to the radioactive decay of the elements that have been produced during the merger, during the air process synthesis. This phase is obviously much longer and has been observed with this grand telescope in the near infrared region. So what they saw in this curve, what is important also is to observe the evolution as a function of the time, which tells something about the composition of this ejecta. In this curve, after 1.4 day, you can see the curve shown here, which is dominated by the black body emission with some peaks in addition that were interpreted as cesium and tellurium peaks. So what is important is that this merger observation gave the first evidence that the air process occurs in the neutron star merger. Okay, so actually this result has been reinterpreted 2 years ago. Actually it was shown that it's not the emission, the peaks are not due to cesium and tellurium, but strontium. And here I show some detailed simulation, what is seen that actually there is due to the opacity of the ejecta, only the strontium peaks can escape. And can be observed from Earth. So strontium is not a very heavy element, but however, it is a clear evidence that a process occurs in this star. Okay. So let's look at now what air process simulation made by Stéphane Gurelli and other collaborators. So I think I have to remove the pointer, if not it will not work. So these are network calculations. Yes, it starts. So first we have a series, it starts from iron, there is a series of neutron capture and beta decay. So we reach here very, very heavy elements. It's near thin 176. Here it's lead 266. So heavy elements are produced. You look at the time. I should stop maybe. Oops. Let's run in again. We will, after about 0.5 seconds, some heavy element will be, super heavy element will be produced here. Most of them will fission and the fission fragment will be recycled and contribute again to the nucleosynthesis process. Maybe you have seen here there was an island of heavy element that disappeared quickly because they are not stable and they cannot survive. So if the question is, do we have a chance, if the question is, have super heavy elements being produced in the air process, the answer is, I think, yes. But if the question is, do we have a chance to observe them with a telescope, for instance, or another detector, I think the answer is no, because they do not survive. They survive only a few seconds, let's see, or less. And at least in this model, they cannot survive. So probably we'll never be able to observe the super heavy elements that have been produced in this neutron star merger. Okay, this is here I've shown the process a bit differently. Here on this plot, you can see the neutron flux. We see huge at the beginning is 10 to the 13, and it decreases at about 1 second. So again, it's a very fast process. And here is this curve. Maybe I should show the laser pointer again. Here you can see the maximum mass produced during the process, which is about 340. So he has shown the time evolution of the element produced, and after 2 seconds, there are only very few heavy elements above mass 300. Sorry, and at the end, the heaviest element which survive are uranium and thorium only. Okay, so according to this calculation, at least there is no chance to produce super heavy elements that will survive. So there is another candidate for the air process, which is called the collapsar. Actually, the idea is not that new, but there was an interesting paper published only 2 years ago, in which they claim that this kind of events can produce a large amount of heavy element. A collapsar, what is a collapsar? It's a bit like a supernova, except that it is the end of life of an even more massive star, 20 to 30 solar masses, which at the end led to a black hole. This star has a huge rotation velocity, and after the collapse, there is a formation of an accretion disk around the black hole where the air process takes place. And in this recent paper, it's a claim that in a single event, it is possible to produce about 30 times more heavy elements than in a neutron star merger. But since this kind of event is less frequent, they can, however, produce a huge amount of material. And in this paper, they claim that maybe 80% of heavy elements in the universe have been produced in collapsar. Okay, so to summarize this air process thesis, it is clear that there are many there is no consensus, let's say. And the air process sites for heavy element has not firmly been identified. And there is a consensus that several processes contribute to the air process abundances. To perform the network calculation, some ingredients are needed. Obviously, the neutron capture cross section, beta minus decay rate, and gamma n reaction rate, fission rate. Since at the top, the nuclei can fission and contribute to the cycling. Therefore, the fission fragment distribution is important. Neutrino physics also, and thermodynamics. So in my opinion, the quantities relevant for actinide and transactinide are the masses, fission barriers, fission fragment distribution. And obviously, nuclear properties cannot be measured in the process path region because they are extremely neutron rich. So remember that we were passing close to lead 266. The first, if you look again at this plot here, it's close. The nuclei it produces are close to fermium 360, I think. 320 fermium 320, while the heaviest known fermium is fermium 260, so it's 60 neutrons more. So we cannot measure the property in this region for sure. And anyway, fission barrier and masses are difficult to measure. So therefore, theory is extremely important in this calculation. So now I will first spend some time on the theory. So starting from the first prediction, so a quick reminder about the Shell model, which was developed in 1949 by Meyer, Axel, Janssen, and Suess. And the great success of this model was to predict correctly the Sullivan magic numbers. Adding an important ingredient was the spin orbit term. So it seems that at that time, nobody really cared about magic numbers above Le 208. And about 8 years after, the first mention, to my knowledge, of a superhuman nucleus was made by Gertrude Scharf-Goldaber in a review paper. It was not a paper dedicated to superhuman events, where she wrote, there may be, for instance, another region of relative stability at the doubly magic nucleus X with 126 protons and 184 neutrons. So about 10 years after, the first calculations were performed by Einar Meldner, who he did this work when he was postdoc in Berkeley, and he presented this result at the Liesekiel Symposium, which seems to have been a major conference for the future of super heavy nuclei, both for theory and experience. So he presented this result, where he showed that actually the next proton magic number is not 126 but 114. This is due to the spin orbit splitting, as we will see in a few minutes. So these results were confirmed by Wang and Zobiesiewski the same year, and many other papers were published in the following years using phenomenological potentials. So the first, a few years later, it was possible to make calculations with effective interaction. And in all papers listed here, some calculation of super heavy elements were made with some simplification, as you may imagine, because these calculations were difficult to make at that time. They were made for few nuclei only and only for spherical nuclei. And all these calculations, the Z equal 114 was not refuted. But other magic proton magic numbers were suggested. A few years later, also RMF calculations were made, and also they did not refute the Z equal 114. Just for curiosity, here in this paper by Brack and Quentin, they present calculation on 114. They say element 114 is gamelgornium. And to my knowledge, it's the only paper where this name is provided. So I don't know why they give this name. I don't know if it was a private joke or so. If you know why they give this name in this paper, I would be very interested to know the reason of this name. Surprisingly, in the Gambier paper, they name element 114 GG, so gamelgornium, and they quote the paper of Brack and Quentin, but they do not explain at all why they name this element GG, or gamelgornium. Okay, so a breakthrough, no, I'm skipping one part. So to my knowledge, the first paper where doubts are expressed concerning 114 was written by the group of Brieur-Lechâtel in 1996. It was a conference paper at the Hirschberg conference, where they say that actually there is a gap. What they mention is that there is a gap, Z equal 114. But it is not magic because there are some pairing correlations. Okay, so the same year, a seminal paper was published by Siok, Dobaczewski, Inan, and Gierski. They did some systematic calculation. This was a big difference compared to previous paper. And they make this calculation for Woods-Axon potential and two Sturm forces. And as you can see on this plot, the landscape is different. For Z equal, for Woods-Axon potential, the minimum is found for Z equal 114, and for this Sturm interaction, it's found at Z equal 126. And here the single particle spectra, corresponding proton single particle spectra are shown. And the reason for these differences is due to the spin orbit splitting. Here you have the 2F5 half and 2F7 half orbitals, which are spin orbit doublets. And the gap is open because there is a large spin orbit splitting for this doublet. But if now you reduce the spin orbit splitting, like for this Sturm interaction, the gap disappears and another one opens. And here it's still, there is, for this slice 7 interaction, there is still a gap because of the property of the spin interaction, spin orbit interaction is this, with this force. So around Z equal 127, it is more subtle than the changes due to the spin orbit splitting. Here is due to the change of position, the shift in position of the orbital I-11 half. Okay, so a few years after, some systematic calculations were made by German groups, and in particular Michael Bonder, who pointed, well, this calculation, again, you can see that there are quite large differences between the interaction used. First, the interaction, the level density is much higher. This is a major difference, which makes the gaps much smaller compared to the thin region, for instance. And in this paper, Michael Bender pointed out two major differences between the superheavy element region and lighter element region. The first difference is this level density, which is much higher. And the second is the presence of low J orbitals, like this, for instance, this 3p 3 half or 3p 1 half. Which has so low J orbitals, which have low degeneracy, and so they and they do not contribute that much to the binding energy. So this is can kill the gap, the energy gap, but not necessarily the binding of energy of the nuclei. So this is shown differently on this plot, where Michael shows the binding energy of this energy. And actually, there is a smooth region around the magic numbers with quite a large region of enhanced stability, which contrasts to the region, for instance, of the thin element. So there is not a marked and well-defined region of enhanced elements. Okay, so let's continue with deformed nuclei. So the first evidences of region of enhanced stability due to the deformation. To my knowledge, was given by Giorzo in 1954, where he analyzed alpha decay energy in the region above curium, above plutonium, curium, and so on, up to fermium. And he saw an accident that he analyzed as due to the shell closure, but as he wrote, it seems that the 152 neutron subshell may be of a fundamentally different nature than the major closed shell. So there was not so much data at that time, but actually it was correct. So this is a modern version of this plot, where we can clearly see the accident, the minimum at n equal 152. Also, 1 year after, Giorzo analyzed fission fragment, the spontaneous fission half-life. So it was a talk given at the famous Geneva conference on the peaceful use of atomic energy, and he found also an accident at n equal 152. So, and the modern version fully confirmed this accident. So, why do we have this differential gap? So, remember, this paper were written in 1954, and in this paper by Giorzo, there is no mention of the Nielsen model since it was published only in 1955, following some suggestion. I think it's Mottelson who asked Nielsen to develop this deform shell model. So as you all know, with this model, it's possible to deduce, to have a gap for deformation of about 0.3, for instance, for n 100 protons and 152 neutrons. So what can we do experimentally to probe this kind of scheme? What we can do is to perform the spectroscopy around 100, the mass 250. We can, like in this Nielsen diagram, we can measure some energies of excited state, their spin, and disparity, and compare with experimental prediction. And here comes the boring part, because these are systematic calculations that we have to discuss in a systematic way. For instance, it was shown nicely in this paper by Asai, where the experimental results are compared with theoretical prediction using different formats, effective phenomenological potential or effective interaction. So there are quite a lot of differences between this prediction, but let's look at this differently with the Nielsen diagram, calculated using the Wood-Saxon potential or different effective interactions. So the major difference is that here, for the proton at least, the gap at z equal 100 is well reproduced, while for effective interaction, there is a problem. It's not at the correct position. It's either 90i, 98, 104, or maybe 102. And the main problem of this approach is that the density functional theory, they fail to reproduce simultaneously z equal 100 and n equal 152, while the phenomenologic potential reproduces correctly the experimental properties. So what is the problem at here in this region? It's not clear for me, and I think it's actually one hot topic in theoretical physics today. So if we move to heavier nuclei, another differential gap is predicted at Z equal 108 and N equal 196, and we have some experimental evidences that this is correct. And all the models agree on this differential gap. And then when we move to heavier nuclei, we have different predictions concerning the iron loss stability, whether we use Wood-Saxon potential, HFB or IMF effective interaction. So it as a question, but it's not a provocative question, obviously, who should the experimentalist trust? Effective interaction or phenomenological potential? So let's look quickly at some prediction related to the question of air process nucleosynthesis. Let's look at the fission barrier as predicted by the model. So here are the predictions for different models compared to experimental data in uranium isotopes. So already there is a large spread in the prediction of 1 MeV or more. Here in the heavier element above mass 248, there is only one measurement made in nobelium-255 by Greg Henning and collaborator at Argonne. And again, there is a large spread in the prediction. And if we go to heavier nuclei, for instance, in copernicium or flerovium nuclei, the spread is even larger. And I would say this is dramatic for the air process calculation, since, for instance, 1 MeV difference in the fission barrier induces more than one order of magnitude or more in the half-life. So this is really dramatic for the air process calculation, for the stability of the super heavy element in general. Okay. So experimentally, what can we do to collect data and try to improve the knowledge and compare with the models? What can we do concerning the collective properties of nuclei around the fermium 252? How do we measure deformation? So the first possibility is to perform a fast timing measurement since the transition rate is proportional to the BE2 with a correction due to the internal conversion, and the BE2E2 is proportional to the square of the electric quadrupole moment. So this kind of measurement were made in the 17 by Ton et al. Using radioactive sources, and actually they measure the 2+ lifetime using alpha conversion electron coincidences. And here are shown some beautiful results they made. And still in curium 248, it's the only direct measurement ever made in this nucleus. We have not done something better since the 17. Obviously, the limitation of this technique is due to the limited availability of targets, of sources. The other possibility to measure deformation is to make CULEX. So in this case, it's a cross-section measurement, which provides an excitation probability, which after some calculation, gives a reduced transition probability. This kind of measurement was made in the cylinder 70 by Ford et al. What they did is they use alpha beam, and they detected the alpha at the focal plane of angle split pole spectrograph. With the measurement of the intensity of these peaks, they were able to deduce BE2 for all these nuclei. And again, the limitation, This was a very powerful method, but the limitation again is the availability of targets. Another possibility to perform the spectroscopy, which was made again in the 70s, was to use direct reaction like alpha T, dp, dt. And still with the N-split-pole spectrograph, they measure the ejected particle, for instance, the proton, at the focal plane. At that time, it was made using photographic plates, and they obtained this kind of spectra with a good resolution of about 7 keV. It's good. I'm not sure it's possible to make much better with a Q3D spectrometer, which are similar devices. The resolution of 3 keV can be obtained. And still, this kind of device is used in the flare physics, and there is one at Alto in Orsay. So again, this is a very powerful technique to perform the spectroscopy, but again, the limitation is a target. In the 18, a breakthrough came with the possibility to accelerate very heavy ion at GSI and elsewhere. And at GSI, they did the coolex of all these nuclei using a lead beam. They did it not to measure B2, but to perform the spectroscopy. They got this with only 3 germanium detectors and 2 NI, sodium iodine. They obtained this kind of spectrum in which, in this example of plutonium-244, they observe backbending, which was the first evidence of a backbending in the transuranium region. And they raise the question of the alignment of the what is the particle responsible for this alignment. Is it a proton E13 half or neutron J15 half? And this question actually is still an open question. So at the same time, at LBL, they did a coolex experiment still on curium-249, but with the goal to measure the B2. This was made using nickel and xenon beam, and they were able to measure the B2. And still, it's only measurement of B2 made with this technique in a transuranium element. The status in 91 was that high spin studies were made up to Curium-248, the coolex, and at GSI and LBL. And nothing has been done until 1997, because simply no target or sources were available to go above. And the breakthrough came in 97 at Jyväskylän Argon, almost at the same time, with nobelium-254 populated using calcium and lead reaction. So there was therefore a huge gap in time and mass, and the reason is that to do this kind of experiment, you need a separator or spectrometer. Because with this kind of reaction, you induce a lot of fission. So a separator was needed as the experiment was performed, as I said before, almost at the same time. I think it was first at Argonne using the FMA, and then a few months after at Jyväskylä using RITU. So the status today in this mass, here are shown all the nuclei for which we have performed the spectroscopy using fusion evaporation reaction at Argonne. Here is a region a bit below where experiments were made using transfer, coolex, or inelastic scattering experiment. So from this experiment, we can learn, we can measure the moment of inertia as shown here. So there is a clear trend with the maximum at n equal 152, but some other details which are actually not fully understood. We see, for instance, the californium, the maximum is a bit shifted. We suspect that is due to octupole correlation, but still we are not completely sure. We are not able to interpret fully this kind of plot. The theoreticians are able to if I can next page. Okay, it works. So theoreticians are able to reproduce the moment of inertia we measure quite nicely, except some details due to backbending or alignment of particle, but in general it works quite well. For this is a plot for even nuclei only. For old nuclei, we have not so much data actually, very few high spin data and other data obtained using a transfer action. And today, the heaviest element for which you have performed this kind of experiment is Lawrencium 255. So time is running. I will maybe finish with laser spectroscopy, which the idea of laser spectroscopy is to perform the spectroscopy of the atom. And what we can measure using laser spectroscopy is isotope shift, which tells about the change in the radius. And in the old nuclei, or when the spin is not zero, there is a hyperfine splitting of the atomic lines, which from which we can deduce magnetic moment, the electric quadrupole moment, and the spin with a number of lines. Actually, this kind of experiment were made again in the 17 in Einsteinium 253 without any laser. The idea was to ionize the atom from a sample of Einsteinium 253 like a lamp, and they measure the light emitted by this lamp and measure this kind of spectra from which they could deduce the spin, magnetic moment, and electric quadrupole moment. So the modern version of this experiment is a laser ionization technique implemented at GSI, the RADRIS technique, radioactive decay detected resonance ionization spectroscopy. And this is the result they obtained a few years ago. So actually, the technique looks easy, but it took years or maybe decades to properly implement this technique at GSI at CHIP. So in this paper published in PRL, it shows the laser spectra for Nobelium 252, 53, and 54. And in the odd mass Nobelium 253, they observe the splitting. Actually, they see two lines, while in principle, they should be three. But with the resolution they have, they were not able to resolve fully this splitting. And for the first time in this region, they were able to measure the magnetic moment and the electric quadrupole moment. So this is certainly, well, for me, it is one of the most beautiful results obtained in the recent years on the very heavy nuclei. So a few words about the future trends. So when the main limitation, let's say, to the study of a super heavy element is the cross-section, which decreases extremely fast. It is at the level of the picobarn for organesson, or less. And the simplest technique to overcome this problem is to use higher Winman density. So this is being done at the super heavy element factory in Dubna, and this is being prepared at GANIL, Spiral 2, with the LINAC beam and the S-cube separator. So with this high-intensity beam, we'll be able to study the synthesis of the heaviest elements, decay spectroscopy, isomer, and so on. Another trend is to perform precision measurement, as done at GSI with mass measurement and laser spectroscopy. And this will be implemented also as the S-cube low-energy branch at Spiral 2, and also with a DESIR experimental home. All. We can think about lifetime measurement, but I think this is an extremely difficult task in this mass region, because to measure a lifetime of a 2 plus state is extremely difficult because of the conversion. Kulex also we need to accelerate, so it's not possible. It's not yet possible. There are no laboratory where there is a project to accelerate or denied, except maybe at GANIL. But this is another story. I think reaction mechanism is extremely important. We cannot bet when we do an experiment. We cannot choose randomly a beam target and a beam energy. So we need to fine tune everything. If not, we see nothing. So it's extremely important, these studies, to populate heavy element, exotic element, and today's multinucleon transfer reactions are very popular. We know that since the 80s that they are efficient to produce heavy element up to nobelium, I think. But it has never been, so these experiments were done by radiochemists, but they were never implemented to perform the spectroscopy using a separator or a spectrometer. So there are a lot of studies made around the world, a lot of world effort to implement this kind of reaction for the spectroscopy. And last point, obviously, the theory we need is extremely important. The nuclear structure prediction are extremely important for us and also the reaction mechanism. So I will stop here because time is running and maybe in a future seminar, someone will talk about this future trend in more details.